I'm T. Barnes. I'm the clerk. That's Tia Milton, the chief deputy clerk. And the only thing I'm going to ask you to do is to please make sure your phones are turned off before the session begins. And I expect they'll be on time. Thank you. She definitely scared people more.
I know, it turned it off.
I think that's smart.
Case, but both cases that are already this afternoon. And he'll have the benefit of recording both the voice and of the argument itself, video class. So, back he's not here, that means not this way.
S14A0602, Jeffrey Wright versus the state. Nicholas Dumich for appellant, John Edwards for appellate.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Cobb County. Got himself in quite a bit of trouble. He was indicted on 15 counts, including murder, armed robbery, aggravated assaults, possession of a firearm during the commission of crime. His two co-defendants in the case pled guilty. And Mr. Wright chose to go to trial, and he received a life sentence plus an additional 4 years for his trouble. Mr. Wright didn't testify at his trial, but one of his co-defendants did, a guy is named Brown. And Mr. Brown was admittedly the shooter in the case. And during his testimony, he said that my client, Mr. Wright, really didn't know what was going to happen over at these apartments, the Sedona Falls Apartments, where Mr. Carbajal was shot. Mr. Carbajal was with three other individuals, and they were drinking beer, running their own business, when
And your client, Mr. Wright, was the driver in both instances?
Yes,
never
sir.
Never got out of the car, never fired the gun, man.
No.
The company said that we played guilty. What was this?
I'm sorry.
The co-defendants who pled guilty, yes, Mark Moon was the shooter. What was their sentence?
They got life sentences. And I think they they got probated sentences, I think, suspended if they cooperated and testified at the trial. Now, the shooter, Mr. Brown, testified at the trial, but he said Mr. Wright really didn't know what was going to happen at those Sedona Falls apartments. He testified that, and this is what my client hung their hat on, was that he testified that Mr. Wright drove them over to the apartments under the premise of meeting with some friends, and Wright went around with turning his car around. And during that time, Mr. Brown walked up to these Hispanics along with a fellow named Stokes, and they pulled a gun. They were in the course of robbing the four Hispanic individuals, and a car drove up, and when Mr. Brown turned his head and looked at the car, one of the Hispanics threw a bottle that whizzed by his head and turned and fired at someone instinctively. I frankly don't feel that those individuals intended to shoot anybody or kill anybody, but as it turned out, when you commit an armed robbery, bad things happen. During that time, Mr. Wright's car comes back towards where the individual Stokes and Brown were. They jumped in the car and they left. They were later caught. The security guard followed them, and within the car they found a pistol that was used in the shooting. The ballistics matched. The ballistics also matched a shell casing that was found at an armed robbery 4 days previous to that. Mr. Wright allegedly was driving his car on both occasions. So one of the issues that we raised on appeal was the state had a fair amount of evidence in this case, but they decided they wanted to bring in a prior similar transaction that occurred 4 years earlier involving Mr. Wright. And as usual, the analysis often focuses on the sufficient similarities of the former crime and the crime for which the individual was charged. Under the Williams versus State case, 1991 case, which is cited in the briefs, all the briefs, those similar transactions are supposed to be admitted only if there's a proper purpose for them, the accused is shown to have committed the prior offense, and there's sufficient similarities. And the trial judge's decision on admission will not be reversed unless it was clearly erroneous. And we're contesting on appeal that his decision was clearly erroneous. That when you look at the prior crime that occurred 4 years earlier, the similarities that were said.
How many years earlier did you say was the intentional?
Four years previous, yes. When my client was a juvenile, at this point when he was with Brown and Stokes, he was an adult at that time. But the state focuses on a number of similarities that they claim permit for the admission of the prior similar act. For example, one of them is that it occurred, that there were three assailants involved in both cases. But if you look deeper, the three assailants in the earlier case back in 2004 were three individuals, but they weren't the same individuals that had committed any kind of offenses in 2008. In 2004, there were two black fellows and one white fellow. One of the people was wearing a mask, one was wearing a hoodie. Nobody was in a car, nobody had a gun. And basically what happened was the victim in that previous incident, his name is Trevor Norris, said he was walking home, and we're not sure of the time when he was walking home, said that these three fellows were on the street, and basically, for lack of a better word, they bum rushed him. They came running at him. And he took off, made it into his house. Mr. Wright made it into the house too. But like I said, there was no gun, they grappled and fought. But in the latter incidents, both in the Carbajal shooting, and Mr. Wright was also charged with the armed robbery of a Andre Lard, in that incident, they never grappled with anybody, never fought with anybody. In the latter two incidents, the armed robbery of Mr. Lard, and in the incident involving Mr. Carbajal and the other three Hispanics, you know, a gun was used, a gun was fired. I don't think there was very, very few similarities, although the state has cited what they consider similarities, such as they both happened in a residential neighborhood. Well, I can't deny that. At the Carbajal shooting, it was in an apartment complex, but nobody was around but those four guys. In the Andre Lard robbery, that occurred in a residential area. They just pulled up to an individual and pulled a gun on him, and they took his wallet, took all his clothes, and set him off running, I guess, in just his underwear. They took his clothes, too. Nothing like that occurred in the Carbajal shooting or in the incident involving Mr. Lard. Gun was fired in both of the latter incidents. There was not even a gun, and there was no car. So in looking at the overall order of the trial court, when he made the ruling on permitting the prior incidents, the trial court basically held that the state has burden of establishing the identity of the accused, sufficient similarity between the offenses, and that the evidence being offered was for appropriate purpose. The court discussed similarities as being the charged offenses and pro-offer similar transaction included but not limited to following the dates and proximity and time between the offenses. I don't think that's a similarity in our situation. It's a 4 year difference. The age of the defendant when the crimes were committed. Of course, he was 4 years older, an adult, as opposed to being in high school and a 16-year-old in the earlier incident. I don't think that's a similarity. see the time the offenses were committed. Well, in the Carbajal shooting, where Mr. Carbajal was died, that occurred like about 11:45, late at night. In the Andre Lard incident, I believe that occurred sometime in the afternoon. And we don't even know what time the Chuck Norris incident occurred, because he said he was just walking home and no time was given. And nobody justifies the time. So I don't think that was a similarity as cited by the trial court here. Of course, he committed in the populated residential areas. I did mention that already. The location of the offenses and the number of conspirators supposedly is a similarity too. The number of conspirators, I did address that. There's a difference between, sure there were three, but you know, one, there were three black males, not wearing any masks, not wearing any hoodies, as opposed to two black males, one white male, wearing a mask, wearing hoodies. I don't think that's a similarity either. You know, they talk about the methodology. The methodology was totally different. Between, this is cited as a similarity, the methodology wasn't even close to being the same in either the armed robbery of Mr. Lager or in the shooting of Mr. Carbajal. When you compare that with what happened with Trevor Norris, that was just on the street, a bunch of young kids. Who knows why, and Mr. Norris didn't know for sure why they attacked him. He theorized it might have been because they thought he had some money from selling drugs or from selling a four-wheeler that he had, but he really wasn't sure. Mr. Wright, when they broke in the house and they were grappling, he kept saying, "Where's the money?" But we didn't know what money he was talking about. It could have been something from school. They were all in high school together at the same time. The nature of the crimes, of course, they were all robberies. And the victimology, that's an interesting issue there that is cited, and I'm not sure where that came from. Victimology, as I had to look it up. It was defined as the study of ways in which behavior of the crime victims might have contributed to their victimization. And I don't recall any testimony relating to that, yet it is in the court's order. So our position was that this similarity or prior similar transaction evidence should have never come in. And it operated to make things worse for Mr. Wright during his trial. I think that evidence, when combined with the next thing I wanted to talk about, which was the admission of a transcript of a guilty plea into evidence. I've never seen this quite happen before. I've been doing appellate work, first with the Attorney General's office for about 10 years, and since that time, about another 15 years. I've never seen a situation where an entire guilty plea transcript came in for impeachment of a witness. One of the witnesses who testified at trial was a Mr. Stokes, who was a co-defendant. Mr. Stokes pled guilty. And during the course of his guilty plea, he made a lot of statements. He made quite a few statements. He made quite a few statements that conflicted with his testimony. I can't really complain about those at all, because Mr. Stokes indicated at first he wasn't going to testify at all. He was going to be silent, but yet he did come in there, and when he was asked questions by the prosecutor, he decided he was going to answer some of the questions. And so he made some conflicting statements, such as, I wasn't even there. I don't know what happened at those Sedona Falls Apartments. And I think he asked him, well, what kind of car were you driving? Well, I don't know, because I wasn't there. And so, of course, that conflicted directly with his guilty plea. But the thing that really concerned me on this case was there was a lot of discussion between defense counsel, the prosecutor, and the judge about the admission and how they were going to, admission of that plea transcript, and how they were going to impeach Mr. Stokes if he made conflicting statements. I know the state has raised arguments saying that the appellant has waived his right to bring up on appeal confrontation clause issues. And the way the confrontation clause issue comes about in this case was that Mr. Stokes, of course, made conflicting statements. Mr. Evans, the prosecutor, did a great job tying it down every which way. And so he wanted to use the guilty plea transcript to come in. Stokes had been granted testimonial immunity by the trial court, so he had to testify. And when he did make some statements, they, as I said, they conflicted. Well, the prosecutor, trial prosecutor, felt like, well, the best way to impeach him is through the use of his guilty plea transcript. The big problem that I see was they didn't just use Mr. Wright's conflicting statements against him. They didn't show him the transcript and say, can you read over lines 10 through 5? Does that merge with what you're saying right now? When were you lying, then or now, whatever. But they also used the entire, almost the entire transcript. There were a few parts that were redacted from it. But the main thing that they used that I felt was improper was the statement of the prosecutor at the beginning of the guilty plea proceeding. Quite often, as they do in guilty plea proceedings, the prosecutor will make a statement about the crime to basically show the trial court there is some basis for accepting a plea. And what happened was, Mr. Evans, the prosecutor, he did a great job explaining things to the judge, and he went through the whole kit and caboodle, everything that happened, everything that he felt led to show Mr. Wright's guilt. And part of the problem is he was testifying. Those were not prior conflicting statements of the defendant. It was Mr. Evans testifying. He wasn't testifying on the witness stand, but you had the jury sitting there listening to him describe the entire transaction, the entire incident that happened. And of course, prosecutors are going to hold a lot of weight with the jury, I would think. And then the judge also made some comments that were read into. And
that was objected to, wasn't it?
But that's an interesting issue, too. They have said that the trial counsel, Mr. Foster, did not object when this came in. But I think, and I've cited it to the court, places in the transcript where I felt there was at least sufficient objection. When they first brought this up, Mr. Foster said, well, Judge, I've got a concern about the confrontation issue here. And the judge said something like, well, I do too, but we're going to see how this goes. And went along. And then he objected right along, even at the time, approximate time when they were discussing the transcript coming in. Mr. Foster said, I object to the entire thing coming in. I mean, I'm not going to agree to anything, even the part that's been redacted and all that come in. And I think a key word is, and I don't have it right here in front of me, I should have wrote it down. At one time he says to the judge, right before it was admitted, this is just like Mr. Evans testifying. We can't confront him, you know? And I think the judge could understand from, he didn't use the magic word, this violates his right to confront witnesses. But I think if you read through that transcript portion, he conveys that feeling across to the judge. And I think the judge felt like, well, you know, he said that he was coerced into pleading guilty, so this whole thing ought to come in. But I think there's still a problem with the way they did the impeachment. And I think if you combine that along with the prior similar transactions, the combination of those two would have operated to deprive him of a fundamentally fair trial. It's just on that issue and on the similar transaction issue, I think the court's just going to have to look at what was said, you know, and On the similar transaction questions, of course, you have to weigh the, I know the court's going to look at the similarities and not the differences. We feel like even the similarities that are cited, if you really look into them, they're not really similarities. And so I was trying to, because we all knew what the law was in that area, that you're going to focus on the similarities, not the differences. So I was really trying to do that for my client. And on the admission of the entire plea transcript, I kind of felt like there was a sufficient objection, and it just shouldn't have come in, because that's not the way you would be to witness, by use of a prosecutor's statement against them. But see, I've used up my time. Thank you very much for your attention. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Mr. Edwards?
Thank you. The court, please. My name is John Edwards. I'm a member of the Cobb County District Attorney's Office. Here on behalf of the state of Georgia. If I could begin by saying that, in my opinion, this was a case that involved a great deal of evidence of guilt against this appellant. I would respectfully submit that this evidence was overwhelming evidence of guilt. The trial court believed that it was, and repeated that in the order denying the motion for the trial. If, in fact, this court finds that the evidence against Wright is overwhelming, then even, I'm not conceding there is, but even if there is merit to any of the four integrations of error that the appellant has raised, then the overwhelming evidence of guilt would prevent the necessity of that being found reversible error. So it would be harmless error if it is error at all. And that being said, I answer some of the arguments that the appellant has made, starting with the similar transaction. He's argued that they're not really similar transactions at all. The similar transaction was of an attempted robbery of a young man named Trevor Norris. Norris testified that he was walking home, that he saw three people who he knew sitting on a curb across from his house. Wright and two other people. He knew these people because they went to high school with him. And then, of course, he later identified Wright in court. He said it looked funny as he got closer to his house. They broke him. They started chasing him. He got to the door, managed to get in, and deadbolted the lock, and kept two of them out, but Wright got in. They physically fought, and all the time, and while they're fighting, he said that Wright repeated, "Where's the money? Where's the money? Maybe give me the money, but at least where's the money?" Eventually, Norris broke free, got away, called the police. In the two cases on trial, the two instances on trial, one from on April 16th, and then 4 days later on April 20th. The April 16th was a robbery by three people, including Wright, in a subdivision. By the way, that was a subdivision with Trevor Norris. They saw their victim walking in a parking lot of the community center. Of that subdivision at gunpoint. They put him into the car, literally stripped him of everything he had, put him out of the car. Co-defendant Zachary Brown fired a shot from his .40 caliber Glock, leaving a shell casing that's later recovered. 4 days later, the same three with the same pistol attempt to rob the four victims of the Sedona Falls Apartments. This time, Zachary Brown shot and killed Ricardo Carbajal, leaving two shell casings. Shortly after the crime happened, Wright and his co-defendants were stopped in the car a security guard and another person who was a witness following that car. The security guard followed up until the time the police made the arrest was stopped. So there was no question of anyone getting in or out of the car, right, not actually being the driver. Now, the similarities that I've identified between these transactions, well, first of all, satisfying Williams, the trial court admitted it as being relevant to intent, plan, knowledge, course of conduct, and bent of mind. All of those have been found by this court to be proper purposes. The second requirement of Williams is that by preponderance of evidence, the study shows that Wright committed the similar transaction. Trevor Norris knew him from school, was acquainted with him, identified him in court as being that person. Those two are satisfied. The third one, the similarity, so the proof of one tends to prove the other. My argument is that the similarities are that in all of these crimes, Wright is operating with two accomplices, all three of them, the armed robbery of Andre Lard, the attempted robbery and murder of Mr. Cobb. The purpose was to get money, was to rob people, forcibly take their money. So that's a second similarity. And similarity is the type of area where it happens. Two of them are subdivisions, residential areas. Third is an apartment complex. They are all residential areas. The fourth one is the type of victim that is targeted. And I would point to this evidence in showing that. Trevor Norris, although he reported it, initially reported it, and in fact gave a statement to a detective, he did not follow through with the prosecution. He testified that he thought that they would be robbed quickly. He had money because of selling something to the owner, but also because of his words. He believed that they might have thought he was selling marijuana. And he ultimately asked that it not be prosecuted, sort of withdrew it, because he was afraid that he'd get in some kind of trouble. The young man was robbed in the parking lot of the pool, or the community center, Andre Lard. He didn't testify to this, but in co-defendant Zachary Brown's statement to the police, he mentioned, we saw a kid selling marijuana and we robbed him. So again, that's someone who's possibly likely not to report the crime or less likely to follow through. In the third incident where the homicide or where the murder happened, each of the four victims are Hispanic men. A Cobb County detective Chris Twiggs, testified that he was fluent in Spanish and he was often called to scenes where there are Spanish-speaking victims or witnesses that he interviewed each of these surviving four. He testified, incidentally, without objection, that in his experience as a detective in Cobb County and being particularly familiar with this area where this happened, that the Hispanic residences or members of that community are reluctant to report crimes. And he explained some of the reasons, some of them being practical and that some of them fear calling attention to themselves and they might be deported. The other reason being cultural, and that they come often from countries where police are corrupt, they don't trust government, and they don't and they shy away from that sort of thing. So that was the testimony that was entered on that issue. And I submit that is a similarity in each incident, the two crimes charged and similar transaction, that there was some similarity in the time of victim that was targeted. So I would argue that the trial court did not plainly err in finding those three, requirements under Williams, and did not abuse his discretion in allowing the similar transaction. Now, moving on to the second enumeration, which is the impeaching evidence. As Mr. Dumas told you, Nathan Stokes testified and denied every word that he had said during his guilty plea hearing. He denied he was present. He did agree that he pled guilty, and that he said that he was guilty and agreed to those facts. Said that he didn't understand what the evidence, or he didn't know what the evidence was in the case against him. Said his plea counsel had lied to him and misled him, he even said that although he was in the car with Wright and Brown, the police stopped them, that he had not gone to Sedona Falls apartment with those two. In fact, they didn't either, and that those crimes never even happened. So he absolutely denied everything. Now, so far as the plea transcript itself, I would suggest that the contents of what was read in the record could be divided into four parts. The first part would be the factual basis, which was, for the prosecutors giving the facts that the guilty plea was based on and what Nathan Stokes was ultimately pleading guilty to and therefore agreeing to, or agreeing to be the facts. The second part, I recall plea counsel statements, and there weren't a whole lot of those. He made some statements such as that Stokes' mother was present, that he'd been to jail 18, 20 times to talk to Stokes, that Stokes had been forthcoming to him and to his mother, that he thought this was a good disposition, and that Stokes understood the consequences of his plea, things such as that. Very, very few statements by the plea counsel. The third would be the plea colloquy between the trial judge and Stokes, and that would be the fourth in rights and the other rights that he's given up by pleading guilty. And then the last part would be Stokes' cross-examination by the prosecutor. Stokes is under oath and he answered various questions, pretty much said both robberies were planned, and they did them, and Wright was the driver, and just sort of agreed to everything that was in the factual basis and the facts of the case. Now, I think if I heard Mr. Dumich correctly in his argument, I think he conceded that the cross-examination of Stokes was probably impeachment. So I assume he's contesting the other parts. Regarding the factual basis, Stokes denied that he was guilty, denied that those things happened. Yet he pled guilty based on those factual basis. So that was impeaching his contention that he wasn't guilty and didn't do it. Aside from that, not only is there overwhelming evidence, and when there's overwhelming evidence, then improper impeachment is harmless error. There's also cumulative evidence for everything. I would respectfully submit everything the prosecutor said during that factual basis. There was other evidence in Wright's trial, probably admitted and not contested. Furthermore, the prosecutor, I don't think, ever said Wright's name during that factual basis, referred to as co-defendants or co-conspirators. But it's cumulative of other evidence probably admitted during the trial. As is that fourth part, Stokes' cross-examination, everything more is cumulative. And the trial judge in the order denying the motion for new trial also found that it was cumulative evidence. Now, if it was error to include plea counsel statements and the plea colloquy by the trial judge, then my argument is that if that's error, it just cannot have prejudiced Wright. It had nothing to do with Wright. It didn't refer to Wright. And therefore, it would be highly probable that those two aspects did not contribute to the judgment. So my arguments regarding the plea transcript is that, number one, it's impeaching Stokes. But if there was error, it was cumulative of other evidence, and it was also harmless because there's overwhelming evidence of Wright's guilt. Now, in the time remaining, if I could refer briefly to the third enumeration, which is ineffective assistance of counsel. And there were two instances of deficient performance that the appellant raised. The first was not calling two witnesses who the appellant contends would have sort of debunked part of the similar transaction. Those witnesses were not produced at the motion for new trial hearing, nor was their testimony presented by any other method. We don't know what they would testify to, so the appellant cannot show that but for their lack of testifying, there's a reasonable probability that there would be a different result. Also, the defense attorney or the trial attorney did not testify at the motion for new trial hearing. So his presumption that he was performing strategically and not calling those witnesses is not rebutted. So my argument is that neither prong of the Strickland test is established on that alleged deficient performance. The other part is that the other allegation is the trial counsel did not submit evidence of a psychoeducational evaluation of Wright and did not submit evidence of an accident, an automobile accident 9 months before the crimes. In that regard, the defense submitted a defense exhibit one and a defense exhibit two during the motion for new trial hearing. Looking through those documents, I would submit that there is nothing in there would suggest anything that the defense lawyer would have to pursue in the way of a mental health defense. But whether it does or not, also included in defendant's exhibit one in the motion for new trial hearing is a forensic evaluation of Wright by a forensic psychologist from Northwest Regional Hospital, a Dr. Richard L. Stewart. And that forensic evaluation concluded that Wright was competent to stand trial and that he knew Wright from the wrong at the time of the offenses. So trial counsel did investigate the possibility of such an offense and was partly foreclosed by that assessment. So if the court please, if there are no questions, I'll conclude at this point. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Owens. Ms. Lewis, thank you to both sides for your help on this case. We appreciate it very much.
Thanks,
sir. Marshall, we'll call the last case.
S14A0631, Lisa Frady Silky et al. Versus Patricia Carson et al.
Lawrence LaRusso for appellant, Kenneth Gerard for appellate.